15 years ago when this photograph was taken, I would have no idea how prophetic it would become. I was traveling through Europe's mysterious ruined places like Paestum and Pompeii, and I fell in love with the bones of architecture. It was the beginning of a career where I would be able ultimately to walk the line between the past in archaeology and the future in architectural design. In my mind's eye, when I go to that place, I can be anything I dream of being. I'm kind of like an architectural Indiana Jones. And in life, it gets to play out like that because we're constantly trying to figure out some puzzle or decode some riddle as we discover ways of the old that we can apply to the new and make the new better. One of the things I've puzzled over the most in my career is this stuff they call green design. That is an award-winning green gas station, and it's not all that green. It's made out of metal, which uses huge embodied energy. All of those surfaces, they serve no purpose except for to stroke the designer's ego, and you can't tell anything about where it is. History tells us that truly sustainable design has a place that it responds to. It's made out of really simple, affordable materials, and it's efficiently designed. In fact, a lot of the stuff that we call green actually isn't all that green. Double thick walls use twice the amount of wood and materials. Rigid board insulation, which we slap on everything, is made of petrochemicals and keeps us dependent on gas and oil. And these houses that we're building now that are sealed up where you can't open the windows, I don't know about you, but on a day like today, I want to open the windows and air it out. Right? Seriously, it's not right. And it's not green. And history tells us that we don't need technology to depend on to create great architecture. If I use this rug to help me tell time, 5,000 years ago, we started building architecture, actual spaces that we were intending to build. If I take a tiny step, we're at Stonehenge. A bigger step, we're in Rome. An even bigger step, we're about the Gothic Age. And it wasn't until here, 700 years later, about 150 years ago to be exact, that we started designing with mechanical systems and electrical systems. And here we are now. The entire time that we've been using these systems makes up 4% of the amount of time that we've been building. The other 96%, we were designing buildings that worked with nature, not despite it. That was the beginning of an aha moment for me. The second part of that aha moment came when my husband and I went to Chaco Canyon. And I was looking in this old ruined kiva, this pit house, and taking that photograph. And I realized those beautiful curvilinear lines that were laying out in front of me, an archaeologist might document them. And an archaeologist in 1,000 years might document them again here in this house. It's a 30-year-old house, a pit house derived of Navajo design in Taos, New Mexico, called the Moon Lodge, where my girlfriends and I met for women's group once a month. I just couldn't believe that I had had this moment where I realized that archaeology didn't have to be just about a recording of history. We could use it as an applied science and see if the architecture that we're building today would really last the test of time. We can look at our history in New Mexico and see if that actually is true. Well, we have lots of great examples, and the first one comes from my aha moment. This is a pit house, probably in Mesa Verde, and we know that they work. You probably know that they work, because on a hot summer day, you're probably you've hiked out to one of these pit houses or one of the caves at Bandelier. You're like, oh my God, it's so hot, and you climb up the ladder, and you go inside, and it's 20 degrees cooler. In the winter, it's the reverse. It's 20 degrees warmer. It can be, anyway. The difference between the ambient temperature is much reduced from the temperature that you want to be at, the temperature of comfort. So we know they work. And they didn't work just here and then. They worked throughout the world and throughout time. And the best and most compelling example, you actually already know. That house in the top right. Do you know where you know it from? Star Wars. Exactly. It's the Skywalker house. And it's a real place. It's a hotel in Tunisia. But remember, the lesson isn't just take archaeology and write something down. It's apply it. So this is a modern pit house in Saijo, Japan, designed by supposed design office. And there is nothing granola, crunchy, or old about it. It's beautiful and sleek and light. Another lesson we can take from New Mexico archaeology and architectural history is a little bit more recent. It's Adobe. It's the simplest construction material in the world to use. Take some dirt, add a little bit of clay, add some straw, which, by the way, is a waste material. Pour in some water, get a big stick, stir it all up, lay it out. Add abundant sunshine, which we normally have. And you have a variation on sun-dried mud brick that was designed and used in architecture for the first time 4,000 years ago in Mesopotamia. And again, it wasn't just us then. Immemorial, people have been using Adobe. One of my favorite examples is this top left one. It's in Ghana, and it's smooth and curvy, and it's really sensual and colorful. Now, we can take a little bit of that and a little bit of what we know about works in New Mexico architecture. We can put them together and come up with something entirely new that represents our time and our place and our access to information. And we can leave our past, we can honor it by leaving it intact. Another thing that we have in New Mexico that is a fabulous thing to use in design, in really green design, is the courtyard house. Now, we call them haciendas. We got them from the Spanish. They got them from the Moors, who got it from the Romans, who got it from the Egyptians. And everywhere you go in the world, you can find courtyard houses used to heat and cool. This is a modern courtyard house in a high-rise in Korea designed by Oroje KHM. Now, they used it as a light well because they were interested in aesthetics. Another architect, like me, might introduce roof catchment and aquaponics and planter boxes so that you could collect water, clean it, and then use it to grow your own fruits and veggies. The last lesson from New Mexico archaeology and architecture actually spans all of the times we've already talked about, earth roofs. And admittedly, we didn't get it right. Most of them leaked, and they grew weeds. Now, we didn't realize at the time that we could harness that capability, but at other places in the world, they did. And now, green roofs are a staple of green design no matter where you go, and they can look like anything you can imagine. They can be flowery or colorful or succulent or modern. And in New Mexico, we've perfected it too, and this is what they look like, but it's beautiful in its own way. The truth is, we can have truly sustainable design, and we don't need technology to get it. We can honor our past, and we don't ever have to feel like we're living in something old. But of course, not all of us are getting ready to build a new house. So what then? Well, the green answer to that is that we make the best of what we have. In order to do that, well, that's the subject of another talk, probably. But in the meanwhile, last night, we loaded up everything that we know about this, or at least started to, it'll probably take us about 3 or 4 weeks to load up the rest, on the Archaeology web portal. And we're making this information, all of the information that we've gleaned from all of our projects all around the world, available for people to use so that you can take tips and tricks and apply them to your own house and make them work now. We're doing this because we believe that the most effective way to participate in a global change of consciousness is to share what was once reserved for the few freely with the whole. That is how we dare to inspire. I'll give you one tip. If there's something that you can do, this is the perfect time to do it. Go out and get 5 healthy deciduous trees, the biggest ones you can afford. And if they're native heirloom fruit trees, even better. Go to the south and west corner of your house. Plant those trees on the south and west sides, about 5 to 10 feet away from your home. And I just bet that you will love the difference that you feel inside and out.